Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center podcast. We hope that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a word from Pastor Jim Cobray.
I'm going to get down on my knees and pray. I need God. You need God. So stand to your feet and let's go before the Lord. Father, we just come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor, how good it is to be in the house of the Lord. You know, Lord, these people that are called by your name that are here tonight, they could have been anywhere, but they chose to come to church. It was a cold night out. Looks like it might rain. They could have gone shopping. They could have gone in. Of course, they don't have any monies, but you give them some money and they go shopping, God. But at least they're here tonight. And I'm grateful that you brought them to the house of God. I'm grateful you're going to speak into their life and bless them. We thank you, Lord, that as you bless us tonight, we are grateful. But we want you to not only bless us, but bless all the churches in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet. Bless our Baptist brothers and Lutherans and Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics and Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest, Oak Valley and Oasis, Inland Christian Center, the Assemblies of God, Foursquare Denomination. We thank you for the Assemblies of God, Foursquare. We thank you also, Father, for our Catholic brothers and Adventist brothers and sisters, Ecclesia, Emmanuel, Trinity, The Way, San Bernardino Temple, Lord. At no time do we think of ourselves as better than them, but we see ourselves in one place, Lord, in a place of being grateful, in a place, oh Lord, where we're dependent on you. And we ask you to bless them as you would bless them. As you would bless them, bless us. As you would bless us, bless them. For they're our brothers and our sisters. We'll give you the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, with a great big shout, we all say, amen. Amen. Tonight's an unusual, it's not an unusual message. The leading up to the message is unusual. I want to share some things that have been taking place in my life the last couple of months that have been really strange. For some of you, you may not understand it, but I want you just to give me some time to share with what's going on so that you can understand it. All starts about 2 months ago when I got a text from Deborah. I was preaching here on a Sunday morning, finished the third service on a Sunday morning, and then I went in and I got this little phone message, went ding, and it was a text from Deborah. She was in Miami preaching in a church in Miami, a great church by Frank Lopez, who's my friend, pastors this church, and it's a Cuban church with a Spanish-speaking church, and they just, all weekend long, Deborah had been pouring out her heart and her life, and they, according to what Frank told me last Sunday, is that their favorite Bible teachers, Deborah, they just thought she was on fire while she was there. While she was there, and every time she's gone anywhere, if she comes home, she always finds me in one place doing one thing. I actually do two things. I watch the Weather Channel and I watch boxing. Now, if that offends you, I am so sorry, but I've been brought up in a boxing family, and my father was light heavyweight boxing title when I was a young man and amateurs was going to fight a guy by the name of Cassius Clay, and my mother wouldn't let me fight him because she said he's too fast, we'll cut up your face. My mother is a very wise woman, and I have been grateful to her all of these years as I stand before you. I've always enjoyed the sport, saw it as a science. My dad taught me how it was a science more than it was just people slugging each other out. And the higher you went up in the quality of the sport of boxing, the greater the science was in the application of the sport. It was really a very interesting sport. While Deborah was down there, she has this man approach her. His name is Yuri Gamboa. He, at that time, is the junior lightweight champion of the world that attends Frank's church. And Gamboa is a phenomenal boxer who has never, ever lost a fight. He's a Cuban, if you will, refugee, but now an American, and lives in Miami. born again, spirit-filled brother in the Lord and makes his living feeding his family and his children by boxing. He doesn't speak English, he speaks Spanish. And I get this text that just drove me crazy, a picture of Deborah and this boxer. And I thought I'd show it to you. His name is Yuri Gamboa. Let's just put it up on the overhead. And so she texts me and she says, my new best friend. And then she texts me something interesting. He's fighting on December 8th in Las Vegas. Wants you to come and pray for him and Pacquiao. And they'll cover the expenses if you'll come and pray. Well, I thought all of that was very exciting. I said, I don't want to do it. Forget it. I'm not going to do it. And tried to talk my way out of it. But Frank Lopez was going to go, and he's my buddy, and we were going to meet there. And I said, okay, I'll go. And I went this last weekend. Deborah didn't tell you that, but somehow through Facebook it got out. And so I'm going to tell you my experience, but I want to bring it down to the spiritual end of this, because telling you the story is no good. You didn't come to hear about a story about what happened in my life. You came to hear what God needs to speak in your life. Is that okay? Yes. And while I was with Gamboa, first of all, started off on Saturday night, I was asked to come to his room, his hotel room, at the MGM Grand. Me and Pastor Lopez went in to the MGM Grand with Dr. Baron Gilflin, because we had an extra ticket for him, and we took him along too. He had never been in a fight in his life, and that was an interesting thing to see his face. And so we went in and met him, Gamboa, for the first time. Absolutely a total, complete gentleman, calm, sweet, nice, just great guy. He says to Frank, take off your pants and top. And he says to Frank, for me to take off my pants and top. I'm in a sport coat, pair of slacks. And he says, I want you to put on these outfits. And we put on this sweat outfit, and it's all color coordinated. And on the back it says Team Gamboa. And Frank looks at me and says, he wants us to pray, but he wants us to go in the ring with him. And that we're going to be next to Pacquiao in the stadium. And Pacquiao's a born-again believer, and we're going to pray for Pacquiao too. Which, by the way, I'll just tell you up front, I never got an opportunity to pray for him. Somehow, every time I was going in to pray for him, it was stopped. And most of you know the results of that fight. There was 160 million people around the world watching this fight. I'm saying to myself, what in the world am I doing here? I'm going to pray for a boxer. I'm for 2 months asking God, God, what do I pray? How do I pray for a boxer? Oh, God. Let him beat the crap out of the other. What do I pray? You know, what do I pray? I'm totally like stunned, you know, like, what do I pray, God? So he asked me in his room, he says, let's get together, let's pray, because he's a really neat Christian. And I just jumped up and I grabbed him. And my size to his size, let me show you a picture of me and him together in the room with my suit on. Believe me, that guy could whip me in no time at all, man. See, I'm like a double heavyweight. But this guy, he is without a doubt the most amazing, talented, gifted, loving, wonderful Christian man I've ever met. And I absolutely adore him. And so I didn't know what to pray. So I just, as soon as they said, let's pray, I was like a bulldog. It was like I was a bulldog starved for a month, and there was a piece of meat in front of me. And I jumped up and I grabbed a hold of him and I said, let me get my hands on you. And I went and put my hands, I just started, and the words, I got out of myself and the words just started bursting out. He starts twitching like this, man. He's having a Pentecostal experience. When I finished it, it was so cool because God just fell on the place, fell on the place. And from that moment on, this young man was so wise, he would not let his pastor Frank and myself out of his sight for the rest of the night. So we've got these outfits on that say Gamboa Team. We're down now, taken into the stadium. There's 18,000 wild people. By the way, these people have been drinking for 5 fights. I am not used to that. I'm used to you coming in after having a beer on a Saturday night, and that I have to slap around you to tell you to stop it. But these people have been drinking for 5 fights, man. And so they're getting ready for Pacquiao, but the fight before Pacquiao was Gamboa and this other guy. And so I'm in there for like 3 hours before the fight while they're loosening up and tying his hands and all that stuff. Everybody you can think of comes in that's any boxing hero. Sugar Ray Leonard, Sugar Ray Mosley, all of them, name them, they were there sitting next to me, talking to me. This guy comes in by the name of 50 Cent. Do you think I know who 50 Cent is? They say, this is 50 Cent. And I'm going, that's too bad. I have no idea who 50 Cent is, man. All I know is he's a half a buck. So the first thing, I mean, he's so respectful. Gamboa is so respectful. He didn't introduce his father, didn't introduce his manager, didn't introduce his attorneys, didn't introduce his cut men and his corner men, didn't introduce. First thing he does is he grabs Pastor Frank and myself and introduces us to 50 Cent. 50 Cent looks, you're here to pray? He says these words to me, you pray for me, I'll get in there and fight. I had no idea who 50 Cent is. That's all I know is he looked like T-Bone. They all wear the same kind of clothes. Like, it's like there's a rapper uniform, you know what I mean? And they all talk like this. I had no idea who the guy was. I'm just sitting there. Along with that, here's all the movie stars start coming in. They're sitting down, they're talking. Mick Romney comes, he's left 2 times to about 2-3 feet from me greeting Pacquiao and all this. But I can't get to Pacquiao to pray for him. I'm not pushing it very hard because I just kind of like to be a fly on the wall. I'm really out of place here, you know what I mean? So I said, okay, they're getting ready to go into the fight. So here they're getting in the training room. Let's just show a picture of the training room. And they're wrapping his hands, and they're getting ready. Next picture, just pop up the one with his, he's sparring with his father here in the room. I'm just sitting to the right, and see the little gray box to the right? I'm just to the right of that. This guy on the left, I forgot his name, he's world champion boxer too, and from Cuba, and so they're working out. Now, the thing that they're telling me is that in order to go into the ring, they had to have a bracelet, a certain kind of bracelet on. They put that on me, so they're taking me in through this tunnel, like these tunnels here, and you come into the stadium. And when they do, you know, the boxer has his hood on, and he's jazzed, and then behind him are a bunch of people. But it's me. And it's like, you know, and so Frank is next to me. And there's like 18,000 people going nuts, and the cameras are going nuts. And here's Gamboa and his father, and then Frank on my right side and me. And the music from 50 Cent is going like this, you know. And the people are screaming and going like crazy. And I'm looking at Frank saying, what in the world am I doing here? And Frank's the only man I'll ever let hold my hand. He held my hand as I went into the arena. True story. True story. When he let go of it, I grabbed it some more. Here's a picture of us going into the arena. Now, this somebody took off the television set. Somebody in our church. You better be a tither. Somebody in our church. Was it you guys? Look at you. Yeah, did you get this off of the TV set? You got it off the TV set, right? And they snapped the picture, and look what they wrote underneath it. We know where Pastor Jim Gilbray is. And it went like everywhere, right? And so it was quite an evening. That's Pastor, if you look, that's Pastor Lopez over here, my dear friend. If you ever see me walk down the street holding a man's hand, it will only be his. But what a phenomenal evening it was. It was very, very, very different. Someone said, did you have fun? No. Was it unusual? Yes. Would you love to do it again? No. I want to just be here with you, preach the word. That's a freaky world out there. But while I'm watching, listen to this, while I'm watching this guy for hours get ready, and he's truly already ready, great man of God, great fighter, great athlete, incredibly gifted man. I've never seen faster hands, more powerful. There's not an ounce of fat on this man. Every time I stood around him and looked around, I went like this. And it didn't do any good at all. I mean, the guy is like chiseled in every area of his life. He's just amazing. And he's a really, you know what I loved about it? He's a real good representative of Jesus Christ. He's like what a kid ought to be and find for a hero. There's so many people that are sleazes out there. This is a really good man by the name of Yarny Gamboa. So you're just going to really hear, I believe, a lot about him. And of course, he won his battle that night because I prayed for him. No, he won his battle because God is with him, and we're going to talk about that. Tonight, as I watched him, I kept thinking over and over again, preparing for the battles of life is the title, and this is part number one. I'm going to go kind of fast because I don't want to hold up the whole evening. It was a long introduction, but at least you know where I was last weekend. Deborah said, oh, he's with other pastors. People asked her at the door, where's Pastor Jim? He's with other pastors. I was. Frank holding my hand. I want you to go with me to 2 Timothy 3rd chapter. Preparing for the battles of life. Let me just say this to you. I don't care who you are, how great a Christian you are, you will have battles. You will have battles in your family. You will have battles in your marriages. You'll have battles in the economics. I don't care how much money you have. There will always be battles because it's just what it is that develops us to be the character that God wants us to be. Someone said to me one time, if God's in control, why doesn't he just get rid of the devil? Why isn't life just easy all the time and pleasant? Loving and caring for each other. Because if we had that kind of a life, we would never develop. We would never grow. We're going to talk about this all weekend long in our message out of Hebrews, the 5th chapter, verse number 7, which is one of my favorite verses in the Bible. You will find that adversity literally will cause your character to come out and be refined and defined to be what God would have you to be. God is not here to eliminate the problem. You're here to grab a hold of the grace of God in the midst of a problem. Paul writes these words in 2 Corinthians, when I'm weak, meaning Paul, then I'm strong. In other words, when I'm weak, then God comes in. I had to learn that the hard way. And oftentimes we're in a battle and we want to give up. Did you know that almost 50% of every person that ever had pressure on them as a Christian doesn't understand the pressure and where it comes from, therefore gives up on God, is frustrated with God, even ended up cursing God, which is totally stupid. When God, if you'll just hang in there, will take you past that into the glory that God has for you, because the Bible says all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose, but you will be in a battle and win the battle before you get into the promised land. And a lot of times people just want the promised land without a battle. And like Pastor Deborah said not too long ago, there will always be a giant before your promised land. There's always somebody and something you're going to have to deal with, an emotion. There'll always be a battle. And if you're not prepared, can you imagine that boxer not being prepared getting in that ring? It would have been a completely different result. And anybody that's great, and anybody that's going to be a champion, anybody that's going to be a winner, is going to be somebody who is prepared, not for the battle you're in today, but for the battle you will be in tomorrow. There will be one tomorrow, and you better be ready for the battle tomorrow, and you get ready for that battle today. You do not get ready for tomorrow's battle tomorrow. It's too late. You didn't see Gamboa starting to exercise real hard inside of that locker room when I was there with him getting ready to go in. He was already primed, man. He was pumped. He was ready. He had had months of training. He was ready to get the job done. And what we do as Christians, we wait until the battle comes, and then we fall apart and wonder where God is. We should have been ready for the battle before it comes. Are you following me? And if you're not ready, then what happens? You'll never win the battle. Because battles will come your way in every area of your life. That doesn't mean they defeat you. It means you defeat them and you learn how to do it. When you're knocked down, you learn how to get back up and keep on going. Are you following me? This word says in 2 Timothy 3rd chapter, verse number 10, but you have carefully followed my doctrine, Paul writes, manner of life and purpose and faith and long-suffering love and perseverance. And then he uses in verse number 11 an interesting word, persecutions and afflictions. Wow. Which happened to me in Antioch and Iconium and Lystra. What persecutions I endured. I want you as a pastor who loves you very much, be so prepared that when life absolutely comes against you, you're an endurer. You're not a give upper. You're not one that lays down and quits. You're the one that gets up and keeps on going. Will you get knocked down? You better believe it. But that's what this is all about. It's in the knocking down that you get the opportunity to get back up. And when you get back up, that's when you win the battle. Is anybody listening? And he says, I endured, and out of them all, the Lord. Oh, thank God for that verse. The Lord delivered me. Verse number 12 comes on. Watch this. Put up verse. Yes. And all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus, that's every one of us. All those who desire to live godly. Why didn't somebody tell me this? All those that desire to live godly. That's you. That's me. We all desire to live godly. If you desire to live godly, listen to the rest of the verse. In Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. There will be battles. If you understand this, when the battles come, you won't be blown away by them. You can get back up and keep on going because you know the end results. You know why? You read the end of the book. You know we win. We may be going through times of trouble and trials and pressures, but it's not forever. We're just going through the valley of the shadow of the death. We're not camping in it and having a party. We're going through it. And on the other side, guess what? I'm here to tell you something. There's God, and God will take care of you. But you got to keep on understanding you're not alone. What happens in the middle of the battle, what we all do is we question God. God, why did you let this happen to me? Why did you ever let this take place? You knew this is what was going to happen. What in the world is this all about? What have I done, God? I went to church. I gave my money. I tithed. I listened to the big mouth preacher. I sang some songs. I even went to church last month. Why is this happening to me, God? It happens, let me tell you something, because the number one, listen to this, and I like this. You got to understand this. Number one, preparing for battles of life, because there's an invisible enemy. There's an invisible enemy that hates your guts. If you're a Christian, then you're inevitably going to get the things that belong to God. And he doesn't want you to have them, nor does he want God to have them. And he is here to disrupt and put pressure on your life so that you give up and you quit and you back off and you stop in your walk and in your testimony for Jesus Christ. It would be like a fighter being in the ring and being hit, knocked down, and saying, wow, I quit. That's enough for me. Unless that fighter gets back up and fights, it's over with. And the one thing God is looking for are people that will get back up, realize you're in a fight, and keep on going. And I'm here to tell you something. Listen to me. There is an invisible enemy. You don't know it. You don't see it. All of a sudden, that which you don't want to happen is happening. And you don't know why and where it's coming from. You don't know what it's all about. But man, if you're strong in Christ Jesus, you hang in there and you keep on going. Why? Because you're not any different than anybody else that's ever been a Christian. Here's Paul the Apostle. He is preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, writing 2/3 of the New Testament. Man, they're beating him, broke him open his back, blood all over the place, thrown him in prison, snake bit, man, half drowning. Come on, guys, thrown him in jail. You would think he'd have an easy thing. He doesn't. He has a difficult battle ahead of him. And there's an enemy that wants to do something, and he's an enemy you don't see, but here's what he wants to do. He wants to stop you. Get you to give up in life. Get you to quit on life. When there's so much to do, if he can't stop you from going to heaven, he can stop your mouth from being a witness for Christ. Every one of us need to realize how important this is for us to see. Ephesians, the 6th chapter, verse number 12. I'll just pop it up on the overhead for you. Ephesians, the 6th chapter, verse number 12. For do we do not wrestle against flesh and blood? What do we wrestle against then? But against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness in this age, and against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. That's where your battle's at. You might say, oh, I tell you what, if my boss just left me alone, I'd be okay. My relatives just left me alone, I'd be okay. But it's not that way at all. They're not your enemy. There's a spiritual enemy that wants to stop your testimony and wants to keep you broke down, busted, and disgusted so you can never be a witness for the goodness of God. And he is an invisible enemy, and you have to realize that who you're in a battle with. One thing that was amazing to me, I asked the question. The guy you're fighting, I didn't know him. I wasn't aware of him. He was from the Philippines. And he said, yes, we understand and we know how he fights. We've been watching every move. We've practiced every move. We know the counter punches. He had a great left hand and a great right hand, right hook. He says, we know what to do when that comes. I know how to step back from it. And all night long, Gamboa, every time the guy threw a certain punch, it went back. He understood his opponent. We don't understand our opponent. We just think bad things happen to us because God doesn't care. Come on, God's given us the power to overcome these problems. God's given us the way to be successful and victorious in every area. And just like on the earthly battle between two people that they understood and they knew each other and they fought each other and they had a science working on each other. And by the way, you can say anything you want to say, but I was there in the flesh. I want you to know something. Pacquiao was winning that fight. And that round, Pacquiao had him. He was closing in. And he knew, if you talk to him afterwards, you knew not to make that mistake that he made. And he caught one. And that was the end of the whole thing. And I'm here to tell you something. You can't make a mistake. You've got to know who your enemy is. And he doesn't like you, but he'll back off of you if you stand up for Christ and keep standing. And you're not going to back down. Somebody ought to give me a great big amen. Listen, we're talking about preparing for the battles of life. Second thing, number two, your weapons are spiritual. They're not physical. Why do we always fight in the physical? We yell. We scream. We cuss. We throw things. We've got tempers. We're fighting in the physical. We're mad at the guy that cut us off on the freeway. We're giving him a finger or something like that. What are we always in the physical about? This is a spiritual battle that's taking place. And if you don't understand that, man, I'm telling you, what happens is you end up getting in the flesh instead of staying in the spirit. Because if it's a spiritual battle, you're going to have to apply spiritual weapons in order to win the physical battle. Let me say it like this. You'll never win the physical battle until you first apply the spiritual battle techniques or weapons. The one thing that was interesting about Gamboa, when he recognized the anointing, I'm telling you guys, it hit him like boom. It hit me like boom. I was stunned. Frank was stunned. We all looked at each other and said, oh my goodness, that guy didn't take his eyes off of me till he got in the ring. And everywhere he went, he made sure I went with him. And I tried not to go. I just wanted to pray with him and go sit in my seat and enjoy the fights. But I'm sitting in a locker room, greeting everybody, watching everything hour after hour after hour. Guys, the whole thing was that he was in a physical battle, and he brought in the spiritual side. I thought that was amazing. I mean, people that were, when we were introduced to him as his pastors that are praying for him, they went, what? What? And I said to Frank Lopez, I said, Frank, I'm just so blessed that in his locker room there's no cussing, no swearing. It's so nice. Frank said, that's because you don't speak Spanish. Sometimes it's good not to speak Spanish. The weapon is spiritual. If you want to win the physical, you got to start with the spiritual. Listen to what I'm going to say to you. Let me say it again. If you want to win the marriage, if you want to win the economic problems, you want to win the physical battles of health, you want to win the physical battles with your children or relatives or even yourself, you're going to have to get to a place where the spiritual literally overcomes the physical. And without the spiritual first, you will try the physical and give up with God. And that's what most people do. Third thing tonight, we're talking about preparing for the battle in life. Number three, recognize your battleground. Recognize your inward battleground. If we're going to understand, you've got to recognize the battle oftentimes is inward. It's inside of you. Listen, it's not conquering on the outside that wins the battle. It's first conquering on the inside that wins the outside battle. And most people don't understand that the battleground is on the inside of you. Are you following me? This man understood that his battleground was on the inside of him. Let me tell you what I saw. I saw one of the nicest, kindest people I've ever seen. I loved meeting him. He was gentle and kind and hospitable. We sat in his room and chatted, of course, with an interpreter, Frank. But then when he got in the ring, he had an arrogant walk. He had an attitude. He was pumped. He was pumped on the inside that helped him get to the outside. You don't get pumped from the outside to get the inside going. You get the inside going to be expressive on the outside. And so many times we're looking at the outside to give to us instead of the inside that equips us. It's always the inside that equips the outside. And a lot of times we don't recognize that your battle is not on the outside. We're trying to overcome the physical, trying to overcome these battles in life and pressures and trials and tribulations and things that are just lousy in our life. We're trying to overcome them in the physical. We haven't yet gotten the spiritual down. And your battleground is on the inside. And oftentimes, oh, you're not going to like this, but I'm going to say it. Oftentimes, hear me, the battleground is you. You haven't given up you to get into him. In order for me to get into him, I have to give up me. There's not room in my battle for me and him. There's only room in my battle for him that helps me. Are you following me? Paul writes this in Romans, the 7th chapter. Just pop it up, verse number 23 of the 7th chapter of Romans. He says, but I see another war in my members. In other words, I'm seeing something on the inside of me. Watch this. Warring against the law of my mind. The mind was telling him something, but his members, his flesh, was saying something else. There's a dogfight going on the inside of him. Can I just say it like this? Listen to this. I think it was Winston Churchill who said, it's not how big the dog is in the fight. It's how big the fight is in the dog. And it's an amazing thing when it's on the inside of you that it's bigger than the fight. That's why the Bible says greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. He's not inside, but greater is God that's in the inside of you, greater than he that's in the world. And he comes along, he says, they're warring against my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, and which is in my members, my outside is controlling all the time my heart. And then he comes along in verse number 24 and he says, oh, wicked man that I am. He says, watch this. Who will deliver me from this body of death? In other words, I can't do this. My flesh is always winning against my spirit man. My flesh man is always, but it's got to be the other way around. Who will deliver me from this flesh running me instead of the spirit running me? Oh, watch this. Now listen to this. Listen to this. Verse number 25. I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. In other words, Jesus is the answer. And each time for every one of us, the way to win the battle on the outside is you got to get on the inside, realizing the heart needs to change. When there's a battle going on towards loving your wife, you're going to have to get back to what the word says, not what the flesh says. When there's a battle going on raising your kids, you're going to have to get back to what the word says and do it, even though you'd like to slap their teeth out, and maybe every now and then you ought to. But guess what? Oh, don't write me emails. Let me give you a bunch of verses, but I don't want to. But every now and then you ought to. But you're still going to have to get to the place where the spirit overcomes the flesh, because the battleground oftentimes is on the inside of you. Your flesh wants to control what you do and what you don't do, but your spirit man, who's greater on the inside of you, is all about that. Are you listening at all? We're talking about preparing for the battle. We're talking about, number one, there's an invisible enemy. Number two, your weapons of warfare are spiritual. Number three, we're talking about recognizing the inward battle. And I love this one. Number four for tonight, preparing the battle for life. Watch this. Number four, the fight is for your faith. If that boxer loses his confidence, the fight is over. Let me say it again. If a boxer in a ring loses his confidence, the fight is over. And this is all oftentimes a head trip on how you're going to get to where you need to be. Let me say it like this. If the fight is over your faith, if this invisible demonic enemy gets your faith, he gets your future. Because without your faith, you have no future. And without a future, you stay stagnant. And what happens, you get depressed, You get discouraged. You get frustrated. You're full of anxiety. You look at yourself and you hate yourself. Why? Because you've lost what? Faith. And the battle is always for faith. If he can get you to stop believing that God cares, get you to stop believing that God's got a better day ahead of you, get you to stop believing that God's going to come through. Don't know when, but he's coming. Don't know how, but he'll open the door. He's going to make a way. Something's going to happen. If he can get your faith, he'll get your future. And therefore, if he's got your future, he's got everything. And you live a stagnant life as a so-called Christian, where the only thing you have to hope for and believe for is going to heaven. And the rest of the time, you'll never produce anything, which the devil is happy, because now you shut your mouth. Every single one of us need to realize this. Paul writes these words at the end of his life. Listen to what he writes in 1 Timothy 6:12. And he says this to Timothy as he's going to pastor this great church at Ephesus. He says, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold to eternal life in which you are also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Hold on to it. Fight a good fight of faith. Never lose your confidence in who God is. I don't care what the world says. I don't care what people say. I don't care how many times you've been knocked down. Get back up. Get going with God. He's a God that knows when you get back up, and he will bless you. And there'll be a day when you don't have to stand up any longer, because he's standing with you, and he'll meet your needs. And the Bible says all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. Get back up and fight a good fight of faith. What this is all about. You're in a battle. There are strategic plans. The enemy wants to take you out. The enemy has practiced since the first man ever walked on the planet. He knows the character of man, human beings. But there's nothing new in how he attacks, because there's no creative being in him. So he doesn't create something new. He just knows you. And he watches you, and he comes against trying to stop you. But greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Come on, somebody, give the Lord a great big praise. Preparing for the battles of life. Invisible, spiritual, inward battleground. And the fight is for your confidence level. When you lose your confidence level, you'll settle for anything instead of settling for the best and looking for the best. You'll lose your confidence level. So if God spoke to you tonight, we give him the praise and give him the glory. Are you okay? Well, let's make sure everybody's all right with God before you go tonight. A lot of times we have a house full of people and we don't know where everybody's at. And some of you, I just sense inside of me that if you died, you would go to hell because you're not right with God. Oh, you're a good person and you know who Jesus is. You celebrate Christmas every year and you celebrate Easter every year. But you haven't yet gotten to the place where you're right with God. Jesus comes to a man by the name of Nicodemus in John, the third chapter. And he tells Nicodemus, you must be born again. A lot of times we don't understand what born again means. It means giving God all of your heart. It means giving God all of your life. See, just knowing about him, being a nice person that fits into society, celebrating Christmas, Easter, are calling yourself a Christian because your mom and dad said you were a Christian. Maybe they took you to catechism class or Sunday school or Sabbath school class when you were a child. Doesn't make you a Christian. Until you give God all your heart. Until you give God all of your life. And somebody needs to love you enough. Somebody needs to respect you enough. Somebody needs to honor you enough to tell you the truth. You just don't get to heaven because you come to church once in a while. You don't get to go to heaven because you're not against God. Listen, you're not going to make it. It's with all of your heart and all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. I'll prove it to you. Last book in the Bible, the book of Revelation. You've heard of it. The book of Revelation. Jesus says these words, I'm coming again, and when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Do you know what he really just said? He really said people who call themselves Christians that are lukewarm are not real Christians at all. You're not going to make it. You're going to get vomited from the mouth of Jesus. Because you call yourself a Christian doesn't make you a Christian. It's about your heart. Have you given God all of your heart? Have you given God all of your life? You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Let me define for you what lukewarm is. Lukewarm is a little in, a little out, a little up, a little down. Token prayer, occasional church attendance. Listen to this, lukewarm. You're not against God. Watch this. You're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. That makes you lukewarm. And you're going to get vomited from the mouth of Jesus and not make it. And somebody, wow, somebody needs to stop playing church to tell you the truth. Tonight, it's your night to give God all of your heart. Your night to give God all of your life. I'm talking about back there in the family room, back there just as well as all across this auditorium. Wherever you're at, I'm talking all across the auditorium, back in this family room. Wherever you're at, I'm talking about today, tonight is your night of salvation. You say, well, Pastor Jim, how do I do that? How do I give God all my heart? How do I give God all my life? It's simple. Let's do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. Listen, in a moment, I'll count to three. I'll go like this. One, two, three, and I'll pop my hands together. When you hear this sound, bang! Hear that sound? Bang! Your hand goes up. What you're saying by the raising of your hand is I don't want Jesus in my head like most Americans. No, no. I want to give him all of my heart. I want to give him all of my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, and denying my presence in hell. That's what I want. And I'll see your hand go up. Why? Is that important? Jesus said it. Jesus said, if you confess me where before men, I'm a man, I'll see it. So if you haven't given God all of your heart, and if you haven't given God all of your life, tonight is your night of salvation. Stop, think about it. We've laughed. We've sung songs. We've clapped our hands. You were great listening to the Word of God. You know it's true. You saw it for yourself on the overheads. God spoke to you tonight. You know it. Why walk out of this place and not be sure you're right with God? Why not give God all of your heart, give God all of your life? You might say, well, Pastor Jim, you want me to raise my hand. I'll be embarrassed if I raise my hand. Uh-huh. You might be. But it's better to be embarrassed for a moment than to be in hell forever and ever, ever and ever. Because you care more about what people think instead of what God sees. Tonight, it's your night of salvation. I'm going to count to three. Who should raise your hand? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, get ready. I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your life, come on, stop playing games with God and give him all of your life. Tonight is your night. If you're one of those people that are in here and you're just not sure, you know, I've always honored God. I've always prayed to God. I've always thought about it, but I've never really made the step to give him my heart and life. I've just kind of always known him and respected him. Can I tell you something? Nowhere does it say if you respect God, you get to go to heaven. You've got to respect him enough to give him all of your heart and give him all of your life. So tonight's your night of salvation. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together, and it's your call. Sit there and do nothing, and God will do nothing on your behalf, and you'll be in trouble when the time comes. Or get your hand up. Make that step of faith. Remember, he's after your faith. Rob your future. So don't let your faith leave right now. Get ready to put your hand up and get right with God tonight in this safe, friendly place. I'm counting to three. Here it is. One, two, Three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one. Thank you. There's two. There's three. There's four. There's five. Thank you. There's six, seven, eight, nine. Thank you. Back over here is 10. Thank you. Over here is 11. There's 12. There's 13. Back over here. God bless you. Anybody else real quick? Anybody in this? There's 14. God bless you. Put your hand down. I see it. There's 15. God bless you. Anybody else? I see it. You can put your hand down. Anybody else? There's 15 wise people. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else? 15 wise people. There's 16. God bless you. God bless you. 16 wise people. Anybody else? Anybody else? You're pointing over this way. Someone says over this way. Is there somebody? Oh, I already got you. I already got you. You can put your hand down. Thank you. There's 16 wise people. Now, I just know there's more of you that need to get your hand up. You're saying to yourself, I wonder if I should do it. Yep, you should. I wonder if I should do it. Yep, you should. Yep, you should. Anybody else? There's 16 wise people. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Let's. Oh, there's 17. Thank you. All right, so if there's 17, maybe there's 18. Anybody else? You know you need to get your hand up. Let's give the Lord a great big praise for 17 wise people. Here's what I want you to do. All 17 of you, if you raise your hand, you're serious about God, even in the family rooms, listen to this. Get your kids. It's okay. Bring your stuff. Ushers, you can help them in the family rooms. All 17 of you, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. Get your stuff. Get in the aisle. Meet me in front. No one leaves during a period of time. This would be rude for you to leave as the Holy Spirit draws people forward, and you don't want to be rude. You just see a move of God where there's 16 or 17 people that are giving their heart and life to Jesus Christ right before your very eyes. Let's respect that. Let's stand, and all of you that raised your hand, anybody that should have but you didn't, but you know you should have, you can come to get your stuff and meet me right here in front. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on.
Won't you come as you are?
Yeah, come on, it's good. Good, it's good, it's good. You raise your hand, come on home. If you didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have, come on home. God, good. Well, all of you in front, listen, put a smile on your face. This is a good thing, not a bad thing. You're not going to the morgue, you're going to heaven. And so you don't have to look depressed or discouraged, but God is good. See this guy over here to your left? Look to your left. He's waving at you. His name is Pastor Dave. He's going to do three things. Let me tell you what the three things are so that you're not, you know, like weird and think it's going to be weird. It's not weird at all. Number one, he's going to pray with you to invite Jesus into your heart. You need to invite Jesus in. He doesn't come in because you want him to come in. He went to the cross because you need him. Listen, he comes in your heart because you invite him. He's a gentleman. He won't come in unless you invite him. After all, it's your heart, not his. So you're inviting him into your heart. That's number one. Number two, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature about what to do next. Okay, really cool. Just take it home, read about it, and get back to church. Number three, he's going to introduce you to a program we have called Spiritual Personal Trainers. You don't know what that means? He'll explain what it means. It means meeting somebody before church service and going over a few things so that you can get strong in Jesus as fast as possible so you don't fall through the cracks and go back doing the same old junk you used to do. Let us help you go forward. In fact, listen to this. If you'll give this church 1 year of your life, 1 year of coming to church, at the end of 1 year, God will give back to you the rest of your life blessed. I promise you that. Am I telling the truth or not? Am I not telling the truth? I'm telling you the truth. God, 1 year, God, and you need and you want a blessed life. So listen, you need to do this. You need to give God all your heart, give him all your life, and then give God your time so you can grow in the ways of the Lord. Only takes a few moments. People who came with, they'll wait for you. Make a left turn, follow Pastor Dave right over that way. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.